Welcome. I'd like to welcome everyone to this discussion of Speaking Your Mind, the Politics of Disagreement. It's hosted by the College of Arts and Sciences. It's going to be recorded, it'll be videotaped, and it'll be up on the college website in the near future so that you'll be able to download it and see it again. I'm especially pleased to welcome two esteemed guests, Professor Jamie Raskin, tonight's speaker, and Sarah Bloom Raskin, Deputy Secretary of the Treasury. I'm Celine Marie Pascal, the Associate Dean for Undergraduate Studies in the College of Arts and Sciences. This evening's conversations take up timeless topics in a contemporary setting. How can universities effectively address both demands for safe space and the imperatives of free speech on a college campus? In just this past week, the dean of a leading university in the United States told incoming students that their university does not support trigger warnings, does not cancel invited speakers, and does not condone intellectual safe spaces. He was both hailed as a hero of free speech and condemned as insensitive. Nearly 150 faculty signed a public letter taking him to task. They said, quote, "The history of safe spaces goes back to gay, civil rights, and feminist efforts in the mid-20th century to create places to be protected from the quite real forces of violence and intimidation. They served as incubators of new ideas away from the censor of the very authorities threatened by these movements. Issues of power and vulnerability do not stop at the classroom door." End quote. The tension between free speech and safe space is a national issue that's been taken up by students and faculty at American University. Tonight, we're honored to have a very special member of the AU community speaking on this issue. Jamie Raskin is professor of constitutional law at AU's Washington College of Law, where he has taught for 25 years. An extremely popular professor, he has been recognized by numerous awards, including American University Scholar Teacher of the Year. Professor Raskin is also director of the nationally acclaimed Marshall Brennan Constitutional Literacy Program and author of several books, including The Wealth Primary, Overruling Democracy, the Supreme Court versus the American People, and We the Students, Supreme Court Cases for and About America's Students, which is now in its fourth edition. Professor Raskin also has a distinction of serving as Maryland State Senator since 2006. He is recognized as the Maryland Senate's authority on constitutional issues and currently serves as the majority whip. I should point out that Jamie Raskin seems to be as popular in politics as he is in the classroom. He won re-election three times with 99% of the popular vote. I could speak at length about the landmark legislation that he has championed, the many bills that he has passed into law, his bipartisan efforts, and his stellar record of public service, particularly regarding youth. Let me just say that for very good reason, he has often been characterized as one of the 10 most influential senators in Annapolis. On that note, I also want to acknowledge that he recently won a 9-way congressional primary in Maryland's 8th Congressional District and is now the Democratic nominee for Congress. As a university community, we take great pride in his accomplishments, yet we still think of him as our Jamie Raskin. Indeed, all three of his children, now in college, are graduates of the AU Child Development Center. We feel both proud and privileged to have him here this evening. Professor Raskin will speak with us for about 30 minutes. After his presentation, he will be joined by this group of students for a 30-minute conversation about campus issues. And then we're going to open the floor to Q&A, and we'll have another 30 minutes where we'll have public comment. So please join me tonight in welcoming Professor Jamie Raskin.
Well, good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming. I hope you guys get a chance to come down to check out the new law school. Any of you seen that? It's very fine, so come and visit the law school. I'm delighted to be with you. I want to thank you for this wonderful invitation to talk about what everyone is so scared to talk about across the country, the politics of disagreement, offense, indignation, free speech, free thought, political correctness, humor, irony, insult, pluralism, race, religion, gender, class, tolerance, toleration, and you've given me 30 minutes to sort it all out. To talk about the most controversial issues in the country 50 days before my election. So thank you for this invitation. But I'm delighted all of you have come, students, faculty, ladies and gentlemen, the two people I saw exercising their First Amendment rights by wearing t-shirts with my name on it. Thank you all for being here this evening. And it is a testament to the open-mindedness of this wonderful community that you would initiate this dialogue rather than sweep everything under the rug, which is so often the bureaucratic instinct in other parts of the country. So cheers to AU for its unflinching embrace of open discussion, diversity, and public discourse. When Mimi first called me about this, doing this over the summer, I had to laugh for two reasons. One was, she said to me, we want you to come and give us all of your wisdom about political correctness and the First Amendment. And I once had had another invitation just like that. I had a call from Justice Kennedy when my book, We the Students, which you mentioned, came out, because it was sponsored by the Supreme Court's Historical Society. And he invited me to come to talk to the justices and the clerks and give them all of my wisdom about the Supreme Court and public schools and the rights of public school students. So I said to my wife, Sarah, the aforementioned Deputy Secretary of the Treasury, the highest ranking woman, by the way, in the history of the Treasury Department, who is with us, right? I said to Sarah, I was invited by the Supreme Court to go talk and give all of my wisdom about the Constitution of Public Education. Will you come? And she never comes to anything with me. So she said, all right, I'll come. So we went, and then I'd worked really hard on my speech, like I worked really hard on the speech, and I got up, I gave it, I retired to my seat with what I thought was more than polite applause, and I turned to Sarah and I said, so how'd I do, what do you think? She said, well, I don't know how much wiser they are, but they're definitely older. My goal tonight, I told Sarah, was to make sure that I increase your wisdom along with your age this evening. But I laugh for another reason, which is that we've been embroiled in these political correctness wars. You probably think they just started like when you got to campus or something, but we've been engaged in them at least since the 1980s when we were in college and law school, long before anyone had ever heard of trigger warnings or safe space. And the subject was so hot that for the very first lecture I was invited to give when I arrived on campus as a law professor in 1990, the topic was, believe it or not, the First Amendment and political correctness. And I went back, and that was the very first speech that I gave here, and I was moved to write in response to a front cover Newsweek magazine special on what they called the PC movement, and it was titled The New McCarthyism, Thought Police on Campus. And the article asserted that, quote, students censor today even the most ordinary of opinions. And for this remarkable proposition, attributing the power of censorship to college undergraduates, Newsweek cited the melancholy case of a young woman named Nicole Stell, then a junior at Stanford, who, quote, found it easier to be a liberal in Republican Senator Robert Dole's office than a conservative at Stanford, quote, if I was at lunch in the dormitory and we started talking about something like civil rights, I would just get up and leave. I knew they didn't want to hear what I had to say, unquote. Okay, and this was the vignette offered by Newsweek for thought police and thought control on campus. Now notice, they offer no quotation of anyone disagreeing with Ms. Stell, much less assailing her or censoring her. And by her own telling, she got up and walked away from a conversation before it even began because she imagined that the other people she might be talking with didn't want to hear what she had to say. And that was the best that they could do to substantiate the assertion of a revival of McCarthyism, an ideological crusade in the 1950s that targeted thousands of people for left-wing political incorrectness and drove hundreds of them out of their jobs and out of their industries and trades, and resulting in many of them also going to prison. And I'm afraid that that special Newsweek issue has set the standard for a lot of reporting on the PC wars. But I laugh because I've been trying to follow the return of the PC controversy, because Sarah and I have three college-age kids of our own now. And you know, it is possible, as Celine was saying, that this might be my my last semester at AU for a while as a full-time professor. And so it struck me that I entered the Academy in 1990 talking about political correctness and free speech, and I may now be leaving the Academy a quarter century later talking about political correctness and free speech on campus. You know, George Bernard Shaw once said that we learn from history that we learn nothing from history. So we get back into it again. So I'm happy to do it, and this may be my last and definitive statement on the whole subject that I give. So my friends, it's an election year, but we meet in a nonpartisan spirit tonight, so I wanted to invoke our last great Republican president, Abraham Lincoln, who spoke of government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And this beautiful vision, of course, is quite apart from how we started out. We began as a slave republic of Christian white male property owners over the age of 21. But through successive waves of political and constitutional struggle, we have opened our society up to people who had been slaves, servants, subjects, second-class citizens, legal non-entities. Today, our first African-American president is about to finish his second term in office, and we may or may not be on the verge of electing our first woman president. Here at AU, a once overwhelmingly white institution, our community is now a splendid microcosm of America. And at WCL, the first law school on earth, founded and created by women who were suffragettes who got arrested at the White House fighting for their right to vote, we are celebrating the arrival this semester of our first African-American woman dean in our history. And these changes are a triumph for our institution, for our campus, and for the country. But Lincoln's vision of truly popular government is no easy enterprise, because among other reasons, people are complex and often conflicted on the ground rules of public discourse. On the one hand, we all want maximum freedom of expression, but on the other, we also want maximum personal respect. The problem is one person's exercise of freedom of speech may look a lot like disrespect to somebody else. The tense dynamics of freedom and disrespect are complicated in an academic environment, because here we want a radical freedom of thought and discourse for the discovery and articulation of unorthodox truths. But we also want an environment in which we are not belittled or harassed for our ideas, values, or identities. In other words, we want a campus that's a place of both boundless intellectual ferment and danger, and at the same time, a totally safe emotional space in the current vernacular, where no one else disturbs our serenity. Can we be a place of both boundless intellectual adventure and total emotional security for everyone? No, I doubt it. That's improbable. But can we be a place of both boundless intellectual adventure and basic emotional security for everyone? Yes, I think we can do that. And this is what I propose to argue tonight. And embarking upon the investigation, I'm speaking as a professor of constitutional law, which means I draw not only on First Amendment doctrine, but on many years of experience with heated classroom discussion on the hottest issues, including abortion, birth control, war and peace, domestic violence, rape and the Violence Against Women Act, the Second Amendment and gun violence, religious freedom and extremism, slavery and white supremacy, race, racism and discrimination, genocide of the Indians, sexual harassment, sexism and patriarchy, the Holocaust and Holocaust denial, union busting and union strikes, gay rights and same-sex marriage, and so on. Constitutional law is not a class that you're going to teach if you are faint of heart or afraid of controversy. So I want to start, before I get into the heart of my talk, by taking up something I know very little about, which is the so-called trigger warnings. I don't know much about them because we don't use them at law school. And if we did, the warnings would be going off all the time, because the law routinely focuses on horrifying, excruciating, and dumbfounding things. events and conflicts like the ones I just mentioned. Almost everything we discuss should be deeply disturbing to everyone, not just some people. Last week, in answer to a question, I brought up to my students the Dred Scott decision, which essentially said that the African-American population has no rights that the white man is bound to respect. Now, that's completely shocking and unnerving, but that's our Supreme Court before the Civil War, and we need to study it to understand the Supreme Court after the Civil War, as well as so-called original intent jurisprudence, and the role that the court has played in American life with respect to racism. James Baldwin said, "Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced." So I suppose my whole syllabus is a trigger warning. I do not want to accept the idea that only select topics create emotional reactions or a deep sense of indignity. As a cancer survivor, I suppose I could demand a trigger warning before my students or colleagues mention cancer, or the health system, or the Affordable Care Act. But come to think of it, I don't know why I would be any less traumatized by mention of it in a trigger warning than I would be by the substantive discussion of it. In any event, I think we want our students to stay in touch constantly with the emotional and moral dimension of the law, which is essential to real understanding of both legal history and legal strategy. Finding the moral and emotional center of a conflict is a great way to navigate your way through the twists and turns of legal doctrine. Now, of course, if someone's really dealing clinically with post-traumatic stress syndrome or continuing health trauma, well, that becomes a question for the student and their doctors and their family about how to adjust to the academic environment. If a veteran of the Iraqi War signs up to take a class about war or human rights violations, but is still experiencing nightmare flashbacks, anxiety, and so on, the student needs to talk to doctors and professional counselors at the school, as well as the relevant professors, about how to get through the class successfully. They need a plan. I'm not quite sure how a series of warnings offered through the class will improve the situation for that student, much less anyone else. Short of extreme situations like that, I do not want to play amateur psychologist, and I don't want to patronize my students either. They're grown-ups. And I know that AU has never compelled professors to offer trigger warnings, and that's just as it should be. And I know it doesn't prevent professors from using them if they like, and that too seems sensible to me. We should learn from each other about what works and what doesn't work in the classroom, and I am ready and willing to be educated on the subject by the students who are here, and I know it's an important one. But here's what I do. On the first day of my con law class, I tell students that we're going to be dealing with controversial and sensitive material throughout the semester, and I ask them, what do you think the ground rules should be for classroom discussion? And not once has the class or even a single student asked for trigger warnings. Instead, they've always settled on two ideas, which are really the most basic and compressed version of what I will advance to you tonight. One, they say we should be governed by total freedom of speech and thought, and two, we should always try to show maximum respect for other people in our class. And that's it, and it happens in every single class, and the students always return to those two ideas. But the issues we need to explore tonight go outside of the classroom and become even more complex, and I know our time is finite. So here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna advance five principles for organizing an effective and morally defensible, quote, politics of disagreement on campus, which I think is another way of describing the psychological attitude that we call tolerance and the public practice that we call toleration. These five principles, as you will see, are difficult, not easy, to reconcile with one another, and they tug in different directions sometimes. But I'm convinced that it's not only possible to reconcile them, but necessary to do so if we're going to remain a liberal and pluralistic community. The other possible politics of disagreement, of course, is repression, censorship, harassment, and violence. And this is a politics we should do everything we can to avoid, not just here, but in the broader world. And if you need any reminder that that other politics of disagreement exists, take a look at what's happening today in Syria or Iraq, where people your age are suffering from intolerance, civil war, and division. So here are my five principles, which offer a kind of travel guide for the perplexed through the minefields on campus today. Now, let's see. I can't remember. Am I pushing this, Celine? Do I control it? It's just the button, correct? All right. My research assistant set this up for me. All right, number one, let's see. principles was misspelled there. I hope nobody noticed that. Okay. Number one, speak your mind freely. Okay, so this is the foundational principle. Research and write freely, speak your mind freely, debate freely, disagree with anyone and everyone, including yourself and your best friends. As an academic community, we live and die by free speech, free thought, free inquiry. A free debate, that is, as the Supreme Court put it in New York Times versus Sullivan, uninhibited, robust, and wide open. This is the heart of the First Amendment, which commits us to the idea that only freedom will lead us to the progressive discovery of scientific, literary, cultural truths. Only freedom will lead us to progress in democratic self-government, and only freedom will safeguard the dignity and creative growth of each person. The Faculty Senate recently released an elegant restatement of this commitment for the academic context in its resolution on academic freedom, emphasizing, quote, unfettered discourse, no matter how controversial, inconvenient, or uncomfortable, is a condition necessary to the pursuit of knowledge and understanding. In the classroom, I think it's essential for students to feel that they can try out ideas. I always emphasize this to my students. They may not believe in them. We're engaged in a search for truth and clarity and understanding, not political consensus or compromise. Nobody in the classroom speaks in a representative capacity. Nobody's been elected by anybody off campus to represent them. A classroom is not a parliamentary or representative institution. It's a presentative institution where you present your own ideas or thoughts, or you just present ideas for people to think about. We don't have to commit to believing what we are saying forever, or even for that day. We can introduce ideas provisionally, conditionally, experimentally, dialectically, provocatively, and hypothetically, as well, if you want, as asserting them passionately, authoritatively, absolutely, or with certainty. But it's not a legislature. We're there to learn and think and try out ideas. Students should feel free, indeed encouraged, to interrogate, challenge, and break from orthodoxies, especially the ones they arrive at school with. Furthermore, no one's speech can be stifled because somebody else calls it, quote, offensive. As the great comedian Lenny Bruce once said, my parents came to America in order to be offensive and not get thrown into jail for it. Everybody's offended by something. And if mere offense is the appropriate occasion for censorship, there will be very little left of free speech indeed. Lincoln once likened our liberty to a golden apple that sits upon a beautiful silver frame, which he thought was the Constitution. But the apple, he said, was liberty. And free speech really is that beautiful golden apple. But everybody who's offended wants to take a bite out of it. Somebody wants to take a bite out of it for left-wing speech. Somebody wants to take a bite out of it for right-wing speech. Somebody wants to take a bite out of it for racist speech, for sexist speech, for anti-Semitic speech, for Islamophobic speech, for anti-Catholic speech, for vulgar speech, sexually explicit speech, religious speech, anti-religious speech, snobby speech, disloyal speech, traumatizing speech, and so on. And if we allow everybody to take just one little bite out of the apple for what they are most offended by, pretty soon the whole apple is gobbled up. It's gone. So we have to exercise our constitutional patriotism and tolerate speech we abhor if we're going to save the apple. And so we've got to guard the silver frame that guards the apple. And that applies even in a private institution, especially in a private institution like American University, which theoretically is not governed by the First Amendment because there's no state action and it's private. But we get to decide for ourselves, but we're committed to the liberal principles of tolerance and freedom of speech and discussion. So I reject the idea which has surfaced on some campuses and in some cities of a free speech zone where all protest and discussion is supposed to take place. Usually it's a site on the perimeter of campus with kind of a ratty looking bulletin board or one of those whiteboards with no markers there and a few forlorn people, you know, playing hacky sack or something like that. No, this is America. The whole country is a free speech zone. All of us are part of a free speech zone. So the minute that you set up a fenced off free speech zone, the rest of the campus becomes a speech free zone or a place where people have to watch what they say. So don't fence off free speech. The universities, especially this one, should model the ethos of pervasive free speech and inquiry for the rest of society. Okay, number two. Let's see. I did something before that worked. There we go. Okay. No political correctness, no PC imposed, and no BS rewarded in the academic journey. Okay, what do I mean by that? Well, the university should never impose a regime of political or ideological correctness on students or professors, but it may always enforce the highest academic standards within each discipline. Free speech means no officially sanctioned correct political beliefs or ideological attitudes in the classroom or on campus, period. No one may dictate the contents of student belief or punish students or faculty for unorthodoxy in ideas or expression. Of course, the freedom to dissent, to be provocative and iconoclastic, is not a freedom to remain unquestioned and unchallenged by others. And you've got to remember that. A professor may not silence or discipline a student for his or her views, but the professor may challenge and question those views as part of normal classroom dialectics in the search for truth. sorry, we have a Hillary Clinton problem here. but that questioning is the heart of the enterprise. But now here's the key point. Students and especially faculty within particular fields must abide by the highest academic standards for research and inquiry, and the university is well within its rights to promote adherence to those standards. So, a brilliant Renaissance English poetry professor, for example, cannot be fired for being a climate change denier in his or her spare time. And an accomplished assistant professor of molecular biology cannot be denied tenure for embracing Holocaust revisionism as an intellectual hobby on the side. But if you're a professor of environmental science and your scholarship consists of advancing the claims of climate change denial, you're going to have a tough time getting tenure, and rightfully so, to my mind, unless you can produce a body of sound empirical research which contradicts the overwhelming weight of scientific evidence, and you can explain why your findings are more compelling and sound than the scientific research and conclusions of 95% of the authorities in the field. Similarly, if you're a junior professor, not of biology, but of European history, whose chosen academic agenda consists of circulating the claims of Holocaust denial, it's hard to see how you should win tenure when these claims have been so thoroughly debunked and refuted by historical authorities, and your work will be legitimately measured against standards of historical accuracy and normal methodological discipline. The analogous points are true for grading students' work. Students cannot lose points for expression of unpopular viewpoints, but they can lose points for making up their own facts or departing irrationally from the methods of the discipline. This, after all, is what a university is and what it does. It looks for truth to share. It does not look for lies to spread. Okay, number three. You can express any intellectual views you want, but you may not deliberately ruin the learning environment for other students by harassing them. Nobody has a right on campus to create a hostile learning environment by harassing other students. This is the key counterpoint to the first two principles, and it's anchored in federal law, which forbids creation or toleration of a so-called hostile learning environment for students based on gender, race, ethnicity, and so on. It also analogously forbids a hostile work environment for faculty and staff. And the Supreme Court also got this point dead right constitutionally in the famous Tinker versus Des Moines School District case in 1969, when it upheld the political free speech rights of both students and teachers to speak freely in the school environment so long as they were not materially disrupting either the educational mission or violating the rights of other students. So disagreement, of course, is not harassment. And even a testy, intense argument in class or online over a matter of substance like the death penalty or the legal definition of rape is not harassment in itself. That's part of the educational process. People disagree. It's controversial. If you don't like the conversation anymore, leave the conversation. Harassment consists of a pattern of severe and pervasive behavior that any reasonable person would recognize as deliberate interference with another person's ability to learn. Following another student around wherever he or she goes and shouting hostile epithets and insults at him or her is an obvious example. Stalking someone online and putting up revenge pornography, circulating nude photos, these are extreme and obvious cases of direct and intentional harassment that simply have nothing to do with the academic pursuit of truth. They are fortunately rare at AU, as far as I could find, but surprisingly common in some other places. It's important to remember, however, that real harassment is not a trivial thing. For the vast majority of our history, American public and private universities have been bastions of white male supremacy, where women, African Americans, Jews, Hispanics, and Asian Americans simply have not been welcome. So in an historical sense, we are still in the process of integrating our institutions, which is a two steps forward, one step back, seesaw process. And we continue to see dramatic cases of discrimination in America, such as the sexual harassment scandal, which just blew up at Fox News, or the frat parties organized to promote intoxication and date rape, like we just saw in Virginia, I think, yesterday, and the shocking episodes of racial bias in policing that have been recorded on civilian cell phones across America and have given rise to the Black Lives Matter movement. But we have enormous resources at our disposal right here to combat such bigotry, and whenever it might erupt, and none is more important than the basic psychological and emotional orientation of the student body and the faculty and the staff. And here, the basic values that the overwhelming number of people instinctively follow, in most places, and certainly at AU, seem obvious to me, and together they form our fourth principle, which is pretty simple. Don't be a jerk, okay? Don't be a jerk, seriously don't. Don't gratuitously inflame, insult, and bait other people. Don't make ad hominem arguments. Focus on ideas, not on the people you're arguing with. Don't make the lives of your professors and administrators miserable. They have families and feelings too. At the same time, don't sit on the edge of your seat just waiting to be offended so you can brandish your indignation and show off your PC vernacular and enter what one of my students called the oppression Olympics. Show respect for everyone. Have a sense of humor and a sense of proportion, not just with your friends and family, as I'm sure you do when you go home at Thanksgiving, but also with your classmates and professors. Mind your manners. There's nothing unconstitutional about that. Remember civility, keep compassion in sight. Breathe and laugh, okay? Imagine that your parents, your siblings, your best friends are watching you in school, in the dorm, in class, on the soccer field. So the principle of don't be a jerk, by the way, I take directly from one of my former students who blurted it out during a truly comical PC episode in my criminal law class many years ago. We were talking about a mass murderer crossing state lines and the complicated questions of federal criminal jurisdiction. And I called on a student and said, well, imagine that he goes from Virginia to Maryland, and then another student angrily yelled out, he or she. Okay, and it took everyone a minute to realize that he was interrupting his classmate to make the point that a mass murderer could be a woman as well as a man. And when she asked him if he was kidding, he said no, this was blatantly sexist, and we got into a big thing. And then finally, the hero of the story, her name is Danielle Fagry, and I quickly hired her to be my research assistant, she intervened and said in a very light and gentle and respectful way, come on, don't be a jerk. And then he said, all right, forget the whole thing. And so the original student resumed speaking, and the class proceeded on course, and nothing like that ever happened again. By the way, that was the worst outbreak of PC in my quarter of a century at American University. So I don't see a lot of that kind of stuff happening. But the principle that emerged that day sticks. Don't be a jerk. You can express every idea you have or want to float without harassing, vilifying, and antagonizing other people in the community. You just can. And the vast majority of people who are not jerks, I've been here for a long time, and it's stunning to me how few of these PC blowups we have had compared to other great universities like Yale, where I taught several years ago, and where PC combat seems endless and intense. So thank you all for not being jerks. And I think everybody's happier that way. You make more friends that way. We learn from each other. And you will come to find that your classmates are a remarkable resource to you. You might marry one of them, okay, as I did, and they can come back to help you in many ways in your life if, for example, you ever decide to run for Congress. But remember that these people will be part of your life forever. Okay, number five. When shopping for a new PC, okay, beware the empty temptations of political correctness and favor instead the PCs of philosophical curiosity and personal courage. So in the endless wars over PC, I've always been a skeptic and a non-combatant. Back in my day, I do remember once using PC to describe a classmate who pronounced Nicaragua as if she were gargling, but had no time to join us on a spring break trip to Washington where we were actually going to a protest against the Contra War. And you'll have to look that up because I know you guys don't know what that was. That was before you were born. But that was a characteristic usage of the term. It was a kind of friendly intramural chiding of people who elevated puritanical language protocols over the difficulty of real political organizing and engagement. But the phrase was quickly swiped by reactionaries and dipped in poison. And back in 1994, I wrote an article about seeing a grand wizard of the Ku Klux Klan denouncing political correctness on the Phil Donahue show, saying that people only opposed his views favoring segregation, quote, because I'm not politically correct in the eyes of the liberals and the media. So the grand wizard, a defender of lynching, a Holocaust denier, had found a phrase that converted him into a free speech hero broadcasting politically incorrect truths. And I argued, to no avail obviously, that it was time to retire the phrase, which had been drained of all meaning and turned into a kind of magic amulet for racist, sexist, and fascist to ward off all criticism. But it proved to be too valuable a rhetorical weapon. Today, striking the anti-PC pose serves throughout the political spectrum as an all-purpose alibi for outrageous behavior. A characteristic exchange took place on August 6th of this year when Megyn Kelly confronted Donald Trump about his sexism. Kelly said, "You've called women you don't like fat pigs, dogs, slobs, disgusting animals. You told a contestant in a beauty contest that it would be a pretty picture to see her get down on her knees. Does that sound like the temperament of a man we should elect as president?" To which Trump promptly and correctly replied, "The big problem this country has is being politically correct. I've been challenged by so many people and I don't frankly have time for total political correctness. And to be honest with you, this country doesn't have time for it either." So that is the standard usage for PC today. In the academic context, there are still people claiming that political correctness is exclusively a weapon of the left. This is the theme of an ideologically charged and almost totally fact-free report issued just last week by the Cato Institute's Daniel Jacobson called Freedom of Speech Under Assault on Campus. Although he cannot be troubled to give a single example of actual censorship of conservatives' views on campus, he's convinced that, quote, "the new PC intolerance creates an incentive for hypersensitivity, since it empowers campus activists, again, exclusively leftist activists, to suppress dissent." Now, this comic book version of politics on campus ignores the fact that real censorship and discrimination on campus have almost always been the province of the right, which simply excluded African Americans, Hispanics, and women from campus for most of our history. How's that for effective political correctness? But even at the heyday of all white male universities, when no hypersensitive women or minorities were around to raise awkward questions about date rape or the curricular absence of African American history and literature, conservatives never championed the freedom of thought and speech on campus. Consider the great conservative intellectual hero William F. Buckley, a graduate of Mr. Jacobson's alma mater, Yale, who wrote a book in 1954 called McCarthy and His Enemies, which celebrated Joseph McCarthy in total ideological conformity. Buckley wrote, quote, "It's perfectly true that the sanctions of McCarthyism do constitute thought control in the sense that they hack away at opposition to certain values. But to condemn these sanctions is to condemn the natural processes of society." In his 1951 book, God and Man at Yale, Buckley derided what he called the, quote, "hoax of academic freedom," and strongly advocated firing professors with dissenting political views. He called upon universities to drop the pretense of political neutrality and instead indoctrinate students to fight in the, quote, duel between Christianity and atheism. At the ground level, in the 1960s and 70s, thousands of students were disciplined, suspended, expelled, and arrested for participating in anti-war protests, anti-Vietnam War protests, under ridiculously broad and loose university speech codes. Not to mention the young people were actually killed while engaging in protest, like the four students at Kent State in Ohio. Many of the speech codes adopted in the 1960s were dusted off to go after students protesting for divestment from corporations operating in apartheid South Africa in the 1980s. And you're actually looking at one of those students. I was arrested at the South African embassy and admonished several times for participation in such protests. So when liberals, in a handful of cases, in the 1990s and in, you know, perhaps in the current century, stupidly and almost always unsuccessfully tried to turn the vague language of those speech codes against racist and sexist frat brothers, yelling racist epithets at people in the middle of the night, conservatives were outraged, but they were simply waking up to what had been taking place on campus on a far broader scale for decades. Of course, in the 1960s and 70s, when it was liberals protesting, the Wall Street Journal, for example, was calling for order, respect, discipline, authority, punishment, all of the default positions of the right before discovering the joys of championing free speech for right-wing conservatives in our era. And there are conservative universities, like the Falwell's Liberty Baptist University or Catholic University right here in Washington, that have openly censored pro-gay rights or pro-choice student clubs or refused to let politically incorrect liberal speakers even appear on campus. But so-called libertarians like Daniel Jacobson never object or even mention such blatant assaults on free thought and discourse. Indeed, if a student makes another student feel uncomfortable at Jacobson's alma mater, Yale, or a silly university bureaucrat there tries to choreograph Halloween costumes, that becomes headline news. But if a conservative private university actually censors speech, shuts down student clubs, suddenly what matters to conservatives is the right of the institution to impose its ideological choices on students rather than the rights of students on those campuses to engage in free speech and inquiry. And I'm sorry, but I call BS on this big and continuing PC cover-up over where the real threats to free speech are coming from. This is not to deny, how am I doing on time? All right. Well, I was going to say something against the left. Do you guys want me to do that? Okay, all right. Let me say that. All right. This is not to deny that some very odd notions have entered academia stage left, too. I learned from my three college-age kids and some of my own students that the ideas have arisen on some campuses, and none of this came from AU, but that white kids are not supposed to play music by certain African-American musicians in certain contexts because this is considered, quote, cultural appropriation. Now, I confess that I'm not very familiar with it, but I consider this a deeply flawed and reactionary idea. In the first place, music is music, and it is the proud and ecstatic heritage of all humanity together. I don't know, for example, if Beethoven was white or black. There's some controversy about that, and I really don't care. Either way, his music belongs to all of us, and I would never stop playing the Moonlight Sonata as badly as I play it on the piano because somebody was telling me that I was falsely appropriating somebody else's culture. It is the culture of humanity that we're all interwoven together in. So take Run DMC, Ice-T, Eminem, The Rolling Stones, Chuck Berry, Muddy Waters, Wynton Marsalis, The Beatles, Elvis Presley, English folk musicians, church music, Mozart, all of them influenced one another in amazing and complicated ways, but all made their music to uplift and inspire human audiences. Dizzy Gillespie gave the decisive refutation to the current fallacy when people were attacking Phil Woods, a white saxophonist, for appropriating or, quote, stealing the style of Charlie Parker, Charlie the Bird Parker. And Dizzy Gillespie said this, "You can't steal a gift. Bird gave the world his music, and if you can hear it, you can have it." And this obviously doesn't mean that other artists own Charlie Parker's copyrights to his music. In a legal sense, he owns them, but they have every right in a moral and cultural sense to make music like his. And as Dizzy Gillespie was saying, what greater tribute might there be to your music than to have other people be influenced by it? This is how music and culture work. The idea of a racial culture, I think, is a dangerous one. When I was in college, I was in a debate with a right-wing conservative railing about political correctness and multiculturalism, when suddenly he demanded to know, quote, well, who is the black Shakespeare? A question apparently common in alt-right circles today. Well, the answer to that, obviously, is Shakespeare himself. Shakespeare is the black Shakespeare because he belongs to all humanity, at least to everyone who will read the plays and learn from them. Who is the white Langston Hughes, or the white Alice Walker, or the white Ralph Ellison? We may as well ask, who is the female Shakespeare, or who is the Jewish Shakespeare, which would prompt the reverse questions, well, who is the male Emily Dickinson, or the Christian E.L. Doctorow, and so on? How repulsive and dreadful to think about art and literature as a contest among rival teams representing the pseudoscientific fiction of racial groups. Artists are individuals, not representatives of their race or gender. And the art is universal. When it's good, it speaks to everybody. So the effort to take some kind of Aryan racial credit for the literary triumphs of Shakespeare is appalling. Cultural masterpieces are not the expression of racial culture, an oxymoron with haunting resonances from the 1930s, when jazz was discussed in Germany as a degenerate Negro and Jewish art form. The best cultural expressions in music and literature obviously begin with the individual experiences and dreams of artists in their own context, but they speak to universal human experiences and longings and fears and values and hopes. So I think that we should remember that, as Duke Orsino in Twelfth Night put it, music is the food of love. Music and literature are the food of love, not the food of hate, and let's all play on together. I want to say finally that despite the recurring intellectual fallacies related to political correctness, we've been making real progress in sorting it out. The controversy on campus is centered on curriculum, and one of the best interventions in the debate came from Professor Gerald Graff in 1993 in a book called Beyond the Culture Wars, How Teaching the Conflicts Can Revitalize American Education. And it had a great thesis, which is that the PC controversies rocking higher education were a sign of intellectual life, but their great potential was lost when we turned the disagreements into fights over discipline, punishment, and language rules. Instead, teachers should teach their students not only the formal subject matter, but also the philosophical questions raised by the controversies over the curriculum and the complex role of racism, sexism, multiculturalism, free speech, and so on. The mantra was teach the conflicts. If there's a fight about the curriculum, teach the fight. And you know, there have been a lot of conflicts around the country over whether to teach Mark Twain's Huckleberry Finn because of his abundant use of the N-word and the book's apparent racism in different places. Rather than polarize communities around positions on censorship, yes, of course, you must teach this masterpiece, or no way, how dare you assign a novel that uses the most painful word in the English language. We should use the conflict to teach students in deeper ways about different critical and biographical interpretations of Twain and Huckleberry Finn and the novel's very complex racial politics, the history and politics of the N-word, as documented by my former professor Randall Kennedy at Harvard Law School, and the ability of people to make good ethical judgments about literature on their own at different ages and stages of development. So I think Professor Graff had it exactly right. We should be teaching the conflicts, but I would take it just one step further. We can deepen the whole experience of education at this great university, in this great city, in this great nation today by moving students to act with another kind of PC, personal courage, to step out of their comfort zone as students on campus and to do public service and social action to address societal problems. And I know that you have dozens of remarkable projects like that at AU undergrad, and we may be the country's leading campus in terms of an engaged student body working in public life. At the law school, I developed with my colleague Steve Romero a project called the Marshall Brennan Constitutional Literacy Project, which sends law students into public high schools throughout DC and in Maryland to teach a course about the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and a lot of the stuff that we've been talking about tonight. And The law students who go, the Marshall Brennan Fellows, who are selected for their constitutional excellence and their passion for teaching, have little time for superficial quarrels over semantic correctness with their classmates, because they've become actual law professors to high school students throughout the community, teaching about our system of government. And so the PC of political correctness has become the PC of philosophical curiosity and personal courage as they enter the larger community and take on the responsibility of having their own students, which is very rewarding and difficult and challenging. And they discover a lot of things, too, in a powerful way, like the fact that they go to school in a city which is the only nation's capital on earth where the people are disenfranchised and not represented in their own national legislature, and what that means to young people growing up in that context. And they learn what it's like to teach the case Brown versus Board of Education in a classroom that looks like it had never been desegregated in the first place. One of the Marshall Brennan Fellows brought me a gift last week with a quote from the Indian scholar Tagore on it, and it says, "We may become powerful by knowledge, but we attain fullness by sympathy." And it said, "Thank you." So this project is thriving because of the passion of the Marshall Brennan Fellows. We're proud that 20 law schools across America have set up Marshall Brennan chapters of their own. And I should just say the students are outward looking rather than inward looking, and they're engaged in multiracial, multicultural politics in the community rather than inward looking debates about things like the correct language and so on. So these are the five principles that I offer you as a kind of roadmap for for toleration on campus and maintaining your ethical integrity through the twists and turns of political disagreement and in the spirit of intellectual freedom. Now please come disagree with me and tell me why I'm wrong. Thank you for your patience. I very much appreciate it.
Oh, don't go away. We're just getting started. Really? Another class is starting. Ah, so students from one class are going to another. Well, thank you very much, Professor Raskin, for we are all a bit wiser and maybe a bit older, but wiser than older, I think. It was wonderful to hear your remarks. We're now going to turn to our student, a group of undergraduates from American University who have been thinking about the tensions between public free speech and safe spaces. They're highly regarded by their faculty and by their peers. So joining us on the stage tonight are Devante Torrente, president of the AU Student Government, who is a junior in the School of Public Affairs. Devante, would you please? Americans for Liberty, a libertarian student group on campus, who is a junior in the School of Public Affairs. Two of our discussants tonight are Frederick Douglass Distinguished Scholars. This is an American University premier honors community for exceptional students majoring in chemistry in the College of Arts and Sciences. Sophia Voss is also a sophomore in the School of International Service. Where shall we start?
I will start.
Please do, Andrew.
Is my mic on?
Yes. Hello?
You're good.
Awesome. So if a safe space on campus means a place where you can host radical activists like Patrice Cullors and the Dark Matter Group, that's wonderful. And also couple them with dark artists like Milo Yiannopoulos and Karl Rove, that is the epitome of free speech on campus. But if a safe space means an area where you can use force to prevent an idea from circulating because you're uncomfortable with it, that is not free speech. It should not be allowed. And I am ecstatic that American University does not support such a thing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
everyone. My name is Sophia Voss. I would differ a little bit, but that's okay. I'm a proponent of open dialogue and suspending judgments for the good of moving forward in conversation. I would consider myself to be a proponent of things such as trigger warnings and safe spaces on our campus. I believe that in order to fully engage our entire student body with the many different identities and intersections that we should consider ourselves lucky to have, increasingly so, in order to create an equitable environment for our campus, our students, our faculty, our staff, our surrounding community, that it is in order to have a trauma and identity-centered approach to how we approach our dialogues, and sometimes that also involves things like safe spaces and trigger warnings, and we'll talk more about what those mean.
Thank you.
So I think in the conversations around trigger warnings and safe spaces, there's a fundamental misconstruction of what they are. There are so many students on this campus who have identities that are constantly under attack, whether it's here within the microcosm that is AU or on a larger level. And so by providing things like safe spaces and trigger warnings, we allow the campus and these academic spaces to be more accessible and equitable, as Sophia mentioned, to all students. Professor or Senator Raskin mentioned in his lecture that these academic institutions have for a long time been bastions of white supremacy, of patriarchy. And so these institutions aren't meant to center certain students. And so by providing safe spaces, by providing trigger warnings, we're making sure that students who have often been left out of the conversation, been excluded from these spaces, now have the opportunity to access these spaces and to engage as they ought to.
And I agree very much with Devante's point that I think that the current state of the issue, both at American University and the national conversation, is that there is a gap between the understanding of what safe spaces and trigger warnings are between students, between student activists, and between the institutions that they belong to and the faculty that teaches. And I believe that that's because this conversation is more than just about free speech. In fact, I think it's that free speech is one of the things it's less about. I believe that there are certain issues happening in our campuses these days, mainly regarding the culture and the quality of our conversations and debates, regarding ideological diversity, regarding mental health of our students. And that within those conversations and those issues, somehow we scapegoated trigger warnings and safe spaces and made it an issue about free speech to silence other things that I think we should also be talking about. And I hope we get to that today.
Thank you.
It's my turn.
Do you like?
I'm just feeling really old, okay? and I'm moved by the eloquence and the passion of all of our speakers. But would you spell out, the safe space idea is very appealing to me as a pervasive concept. That is, I think that we need to establish ground rules for discourse in classrooms, in the dining hall, on the lacrosse field, whatever, that are civil and that make it a decently safe space for everybody, if not like a warm and supportive and loving space. But are we talking about a physical separate safe space? But I guess I'm not quite sure what the proposals are.
So I don't think it necessarily has to be a separate physical space. I think safe spaces are more about the ideology behind it, and that we're going to provide, the platform for students who've often been excluded and marginalized to feel welcomed and included in these spaces, but to go a little bit further and to actually accept who they are. I think a lot of times when we talk about safe spaces, we ground them in these ideas of diversity and inclusion, but what does that really mean? And I think we need to move beyond that to talk about acceptance. And so by providing these safe spaces in classrooms, I don't think it's one stationary space. I think, again, it goes back to the ideas and the notions behind it, which you can bring anywhere with you, but it's really just about accepting and including students in these spaces who often have been left out of them.
I would echo a lot of what Devante is saying. Sometimes safe spaces are physical spaces. centers on campus that students of a certain identity group perhaps can take advantage of resources they need that may be specific to their own identities, or spaces where they can engage with one another very differently than they may be able to do so outside of that space. But they don't always have to be exclusive rooms with doors, right? Students who on our campus, their identities may be marginalized in some ways, and historically so. And those situations are still very much present in our classrooms and in our residence halls, on our quad and in our dining halls. And they are reflective of how we interact with one another. They're reflective of the material that is taught in some courses and not in others. They're reflective of who we hire for certain positions on our faculty and our staff. And all of those, what we oftentimes call microaggressions, tend to add up and feed back into a macro system of oppression, of injustice, that is an intergenerational source of oftentimes trauma and oftentimes feeling unwelcome or unsafe in the place where you study, eat, sleep, live. So the idea of safe space is offering something to provide an equitable playing field eventually where certain groups of students can level a bit the playing field in their identities in a way that will allow them to engage more readily and more fully for the richness of our entire community.
But it sounds like you're saying, Sophia, that it's really not about respect but a sense of safety. Is that correct?
I do like that, the idea that it could be about a sense of safety, yes. I don't want to exclude that it's also about respect, but I think the idea of feeling safe and welcome is also central.
Okay, thanks.
So I think you're kind of getting from hearing both of those points that a safe space is not a safe space for civil discourse. It's a safe to remove certain ideas, dialogues that are in some ways, you constantly hear the mention of marginalized groups, things that would, you know, be in some way oppressive to those groups, or things that maybe a person that might be in that group thinks is oppressive or might not be even related to that at all. It's just a place for students where they have similar ideologies or a similar race or whatever the connection may be to exclude themselves from facing any other idea another student has on campus. I will give you an example. When we brought Milo Yiannopoulos to campus last year, who is an awful human being, and I acknowledge that, he's terrible, but we brought him because of this to challenge the fact that unless you directly threaten somebody, your speech is not violent. So if I say, I'm going to kill you tomorrow, that is violent. If I say, you know, I wish you would kill yourself, that is not violent, and it's often something that's used in comedy. How do you determine between those two things? But the big example that I have is there was a protest for Milo, and rightfully so. He's, you know, like I said, a terrible person.
Could you introduce him a little further? Is he a comedian?
He is a homosexual right-wing writer for Breitbart. Big Trump.
Is he the deputy campaign manager of the Trump campaign?
So when he came, there were about 150 protesters standing outside of MGC holding up signs, you know, regaling against what Milo had previously said about transgender individuals. And a photographer went into that group from Breitbart, and not just this individual, but also other reporters went to the protest to try and get images of it. And the student activists that were there pointed at campus safety and said, remove this person now. This is our space, this is our protest, they don't deserve to be here, which is false. They absolutely deserve to be here. They absolutely have the right to take a photo of a demonstration.
Was he removed?
The public safety, which I work for at American University, is a wonderful group, stood there and said, no, we're here to make sure there's no strife. He was not removed, but the people in the safe space wanted him removed, and that's why it's just a horrible thing to implement on campuses.
Okay.
Now, one thing that I think is worth recognizing is that in your speech, you talked a lot about, you know, the importance of debate in the classroom, and that academic institutions should really, you know, keep that academic freedom safe. But one thing that we also need to, I think, all recognize is that universities no longer, or maybe haven't ever been, only academic institutions. They're communities. They're, you could even say, microcosms of the real world, if there's, you know, a good representation of people. And the fact of that matter is that when we see the current issues about, be it free speech or political correctness or mental health or other things, when we see the issues that happen here at American University, it's usually not something that happens in the classroom. It's usually something that happens outside. Mm-hmm. It's usually something that happens within the community, within mm-hmm. clashing groups of different ideologies. But also, it's important to remember that since it's a community, in the same way that I want to make sure that my country keeps me safe, and that I know that there will be repercussions if something happens to me, to the offender, to the aggressor, I would also expect that out of an institution where we're living in a community as well.
Yeah.
And I think those are just basic standards and things worth keeping in mind when making arguments about safe spaces. Right?
So let me just, that's a very powerful point you made. It's not just the classroom, and as a professor, of course, I view it a little bit through the prism of the classroom, and I haven't heard any complaints really about anything going on in the classroom. We're talking about protests outside and, you know, extracurricular debate and discussion. But it's occurring to me as I watch you guys, because again, you're all the age of my children, so forgive me if I sound too paternalistic about this, but you are a generation of people who I imagine the first defining or formative public experience of your life were the 9/11 attacks. And there is a lot of emphasis on safety and security that I'm hearing all of you guys talk about. You grew up in an age of anxiety and unsafety and insecurity, and American University, like a lot of other universities, places a lot of emphasis now on safety and security because we live in an anxious and difficult time. But I want to just say one word for unsafety in terms of going to university, meeting people who are not part of your normal social group, crossing racial lines, crossing ethnic lines, crossing ideological lines and party lines. That's what a university is supposed to be about, that you're supposed to expose your views to the test and to engage in the dialogue. So the discussion that you talked about, bringing somebody who you say is reviled and you reviled a campus to show what free speech is about, and then you prompt a protest where people come outside and protest and yell different things, that's great.
It is.
So that's terrific. You shouldn't be mad at them. I mean, you sort of created the space for them to come together to say this person stands for everything.
Oh, yeah, and the protesters were absolutely justified, just to clarify quickly. Yeah. They were justified. It was just that they wanted somebody else that was in the space removed. That was the only thing.
Okay,
I'm
so
welcome
you,
for those
protesters. I mean, on the scale of what took place and what the events you set into motion there, that's like a comma in terms of the book telling the event. I mean, I don't know everything that happened, but you don't have much of a complaint, it sounds to me, about what took place when there was a, you know, an extremist speaker who got up with provocative views, and then other people came and nonviolently protested and heckled or whatever as people went in. And so that's democracy. So that's good. That in some sense that's intellectually and politically unsafe. But we do want to make sure, I like your emphasis on mental health, that people feel emotionally safe, psychologically secure, and that is part of the responsibility of the university, which they take very seriously. But I don't think we should confuse that with the intellectual mission, which is we want everybody growing and experimenting and testing and stepping outside of their comfort zone intellectually.
Yeah, I agree. We definitely want people to stretch themselves and learn and grow here. And I think that offering things like safe space, actually provides an infrastructure for that. I don't think that they're in conflict. I think that they go quite well together. Students who are offered some type of emotional safety emotional safety, as you were saying, can then engage more effectively with the campus at large, and that is a privilege and a gift for everyone in our community. So I certainly believe that safe spaces oftentimes give us what we need in order to engage fully and wholly in a way that is enriching to all of us on our campus. And I would also like to kind of go back to what you said, Andrew, about threats and language and violence. I would stretch a bit further to say that language at times can be violent, and that, you know, we can have language that incites violence. We have seen many times in our history, as you were talking about the link between looking back on your history, and sometimes we find all we learn is that we haven't learned, but that rhetoric can be linked to actual violence. So I wouldn't put that past our thought process. I wouldn't keep that out of the way. I mean, people have thought about poverty as violence. I mean, there's many different ways to consider what violence is and what violence does. Also, Milo Yiannopoulos, I did not attend either side of the engagement, but I think that what you're saying about safety is quite central to him, his presence here. I have read that Milo Yiannopoulos has said, you may know the quote better than I have heard you explain it, but that if transgender people would like to improve their self-esteem by changing some part of their body, they should start by removing their own heads. I hope that that's unsettling to you. It's unsettling to me. And I would hardly believe that a protest of such a speaker in the place where we live as students would ever be considered a safe space. I don't think that that is in line with the ideology of what safe space is. And so the removal of a public safety officer to provide safe space, I don't think that that public safety officer was taking away from a safe space that was already there. I don't think that that's quite what we mean when we talk about space for people to engage critically with those who share their identity so that they can enrich our whole campus.
So my follow-up to that would be just at the Comedy Central roast of Rob Lowe that happened about 2 weeks ago, I believe. Somebody there asked another deplorable human being, Ann Coulter, to kill herself, said, you know, Ann, it's not too late. You could still change. You could kill yourself, which is hilarious, right? But how do you distinguish between that and what Milo says? Because you don't like what Milo says, but maybe you do like what the roaster said to Ann Coulter. I'm not sure, you know, how can we codify, oh, what's comedic? What's violent? Can comedy be violent? Can you make comedic remarks that include violence that aren't codified as violence? It doesn't make any sense. And on the point that a safe space does not want the removal of somebody, I'm not quite sure what Sophia was saying about the public safety officer. I'll restate what happened. The protesters asked the public safety officer to remove a journalist photographer from the area that was taking pictures. They said, this is our space, you know, get out. That is the problem with the safe space, because it's something that excludes another person from participating in some sort of dialogue. In this case, it was journalism. So when you said, Senator Raskin, that there should not be free speech zones on campus, a safe space is basically the opposite of a free speech zone, just like you were saying.
Well, again, I have a lot more to learn about this, obviously, but when I was in college, our safe space was our dorm room, at least after freshman year, when you could choose your roommates, that was the place we retreated to, you know, if we, and so, I mean, put it this way, I always favor more integration and more mixing it up, and I'm afraid of impulses that separate people. I mean, I know in a lot of campuses, that's the role that fraternities play and sororities play, and there are oftentimes a lot of bad values that go along with that, and we don't really have that at AU, and I think that's a good thing, you know? So obviously it's gonna be for the community to decide, you know, whether the whole campus is gonna become a safe space and can be a safe space, or there need to be, you know, dedicated or devoted safe spaces. I mean, I knew this term only from a long time ago when my colleague Nancy Polakoff, who's a very distinguished scholar, gave me a sticker to put on my door saying, this is a safe space with a triangle on it. meeting that gay and lesbian students could come and talk to me about whatever they were going through, and a bunch of, you know, she gave them to all the faculty, and a bunch of us put them on, and some people didn't, and that became a safe space. So, you know, but I like that idea. But, you know, what's the name of the guy again? I can't remember his name.
Milo, you know.
Milo, okay. I mean, when I listen to you talk about it, it makes me nostalgic, because when I was in college, we always had stuff like that going on. And we really thought it was important, like how many people you could get at the protest or how many people were inside and all that. And not to put down Milo or anything,
but
the scheme of things,
okay,
it really doesn't mean anything. And that's why, you know, if you're interested in the questions you guys are raising about, well, at what point does incitement to imminent lawless action lose its First Amendment protection? If you're interested in that, then you go to law school after college. But I would favor you spending your time in college out involved in a lot of the socially constructive and positive activities that exist at AU to go and help people, because there's so much going on in this city, in this community, where the idealism and intelligence of the people in this room really can be used, like from tutoring kids to doing environmental cleanup to fighting for divestment from the carbon industry across the country. There's a lot of things where you're political energy is needed. I'm not saying that kind of stuff isn't fun, but it doesn't really add up to very much in the end when I think back to my experience on campus, you know? And that's where a lot of these PC free speech controversies come from.
Can I chime in just for a moment? I want to push a little bit on this. Yeah. Because my experience as an undergraduate, when I went to university, I had never met another queer person. And it was only in college, my first year, where I was introduced to a woman who identified as a lesbian. And I felt a tremendous resonance with her, but she was so scorned and such the target of violence that I couldn't come out, I couldn't think about myself. And I left that school and I went to another university where there was a safe community to explore my identity, to come out, and I came out.
I hope you brought her with you.
I wish I had,
yeah,
actually.
So, yeah.
So it was a different space that enabled me to kind of express myself in ways that I hadn't been
able
to before.
The campus was.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that also makes me think about this event, because the rates of suicide among transgendered youth are astronomical, that it isn't a joke, and it isn't speech that comes without a cost. Mari Matsuda makes the argument that the reason that we don't restrict forms of hate speech is because dominant society refuses to acknowledge the price that marginalized groups pay for that kind of speech. We don't allow people to say fire in a full room because we know the harm that would create. And if dominant culture could recognize the harm to transgendered youth when someone says, go kill yourself, or to, you know, any other groups that are excluded, that we would think differently about hate speech. So I wonder what you would think about that.
What I would say to it is that the way that oppressed people have liberated themselves from conditions of oppression, and what you're describing is oppression, where people can't be themselves, where they're vilified, where they're insulted, is by getting together with other people, both people like them and people not like them, who identify with them through solidarity, in making movements for change. And that's how America has grown, you know? And I mean, maybe, see, then here's the reason I don't pass any judgment either way on the safe space thing. I'm not an undergraduate here, so I don't know what it's like. I always thought and assumed that the campus was a safe space where people could get together across lines of sexual orientation, race, class, and gender, and so on, which doesn't mean that you never hang out with this group or that group, but it means generally there's a kind of fluidity to the process, and you can get together with people to do socially constructive things. And so, I mean, I'm a political person in addition to being an academic person, and so I always favor the idea of people being involved in projects together, in that if everybody gazes at each other and just talks about an abstraction like race or class or, you know, sexual identity, oftentimes it'll turn negative. But if we go and we do something, like let's try to help the transgender kids in high school in DC no longer be victims of insult and, you know, demonization, that would be a wonderful project for people to do. And you could get lots of people to go and do that, and I'm sure, you know,
that the energy of the people in this room could be well spent.
Great, thank you. So I would like to give the last couple of words to Devante and to J.I., and then we'll open it to the floor.
Sure. So I think going back to the point you made, Dean Pascal, about how, about the suicide rates among transgender people and how, when, so in my opinion, when Milo came to this campus, it was a statement, right? It made a statement about how, what kind of speech we're going to be promoting. And so Milo joking previously about, you know, transgender people should, you know, kill themselves and whatnot, it's not something you should joke about, because I think that's a very targeted demographic of people who are consistently and constantly marginalized and oppressed. And so I think it's really important to understand, you know, sort of the power dynamics at play there. I would be hesitant to equate it to, the Ann Coulter situation, but I think that you shouldn't joke about that either way. But specifically when you're talking about marginalized groups and you make those types of comments, you have to take the historical and the political and the power dynamics into consideration. And you have to understand the context of what those marginalized groups are dealing with. And I think a lot of times people either refuse to understand the context, or they understand it and don't care, because they're in that the group that has the power. They're in the dominant group, and so they are entitled to having these beliefs, but I really would challenge them to think about why they feel so entitled to have those beliefs. So sure, you can say what you want to say, free speech allows you to do that, but just because you can doesn't mean you should, and you should really think about it before you do.
Okay, Chan, would you like to?
I think it's always valuable to finish a conversation identifying where there's common ground. And from both the right, the left, or in whatever way you want to make that dichotomy, if you want to make one at all, I bet that we could all agree here on the stage and the audience that we all believe in the idea of free speech, that we all believe that mental health is an issue that we should pay attention to, and that we believe that everyone should be treated with respect and with the same, with no special treatment for anyone else, but moreover, making sure that everyone feels that they're equal. We can all agree on those things, but we clearly have different ideas on how to get there. And I think it's much better to try to, you know, go to the other person with which we, with whom we disagree with, and try to figure out, why do you not see it the way I do? And what can I learn about that perspective in order to reach some consensus? We didn't get to talk about trigger warnings that much, but I know that right now it's an issue that the Faculty Senate felt that they had to send an email, a massive 2 years running, for why they don't support it. Whereas students like Devante and I, and Sophia as well, believe that it should be something that should be present in your university. And I bet that both the leader, the chair of the Faculty Senate, and I both believe in academic freedom, and both believe in mental and the well-being of students. So clearly, there's just something that we're not seeing. So I think the important thing is that when we have these conversations, we focus on what we can't see. We focus on trying to take a position of ignorance, not what we know, but what we don't know. And I think that's necessary from both sides. I think the reason that, you know, it's been so difficult and it has taken so long for some groups to feel that they've been heard is because the people in power don't see what they see and have refused to even look. But on the same page, on the other side, we have to remember that if we want to understand how to engage in debate and engage in conversation, it's worth understanding what is it that they see and what I don't. So that's what I think is actually gonna take the debate to be, you know, more constructive, more productive, and have better results. And I hope that that's something that we do as a campus. I think it's something we are doing as a campus. And I'd say that you should all picture right now, what is the ideal campus where you feel that you are at a place with that cultivates great ideas, but that also cultivates a sense of security and happiness? And now ask yourself, is AU that? If the answer is yes, well then ask yourself, why are there people who don't see that? If the answer is no, then ask yourself, what can I do to show that? And what can we do so that we can all achieve a sense that we're living in and studying in the best university we can.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much to all of you. So We're going to open the, we have two mics, one on either side of the room. We're running a little bit late. I know students are coming and going for classes, but we really welcome your comments, your insights, and your questions in the same spirit of collegiality as the conversation has unfolded. So we'll take a moment for people to sort themselves out here. It looks like all the questions are on this side of the room. I'm not sure what that means, huh? Oh, up to you there. All right. So I'm going to try to kind of rotate this in between. Would you say your name and please come forward?
Hi. Is this on? Okay. My name is Rebecca Timmish. I am a junior at AU. First of all, thank you, Senator and future Congressman Raskin, for coming. I'm a big fan
thank
of you.
Thank you.
I won't jinx it by calling you Congressman yet. I wanted to ask a question specifically about trigger warnings and specifically in the context of sexual assault on campus, because every time that I've posed this question, the response is falls down that slippery slope of, well, then are we going to need trigger warnings for popsicles? And so I want to keep it in the context of sexual assault on campus. It's something that's important to me. You're not an undergrad professor. I'm an undergrad student. And like many college freshmen, I had the misfortune of being raped 2 months into my freshman year of college. And I went to class the next day. But 2 weeks later, I had a professor put up pictures of rape and domestic violence victims. And then at the sight of my tears, very flippantly tell me that, well, the real world isn't a safe space, which I know because I was raped in the real world. In my personal experience, I ended up failing that class because I got to the point where I knew that I couldn't trust that professor. And so in my experience, trigger warnings for sexual assault don't necessarily, like, I'm taking a class on gender and war right now. I know that there's gonna be reference of sexual assault. I'm taking the class. What it tells me for a professor to put a trigger warning is that the professor is saying, I see you and I understand you. And so they're signaling to me that I can trust them. And so at a school where 68% of the population is women, and at least 20% of them will experience sexual assault probably during their 4 years in American, and one of the biggest indicators of success in class is attendance, is that really such a bad thing to let us know in that context?
So is it for me?
For anyone. But,
well, let me answer. First of all, thank you for the wonderful question. And, you know, thank you for your courage also in deciding to go take that class, right? Because, you know, we know that war is the occasion of mass rape and massive gender violence. Tell me again, and again, I plead some ignorance because we don't have those at the law school. So tell me how it works. Is it just in the syllabus, or is it sort of for particular days, or is it at the beginning of class? Like, how does it work?
So it depends on the professor. My professor for gender and war said these are the dates at which I will be showing videos or showing pictures that will relate to sexual assault. I mean, I studied gender and international relations, so this has come up before. Some professors put a blanket trigger warning down. Some professors say, hey, these next readings might be difficult, reach out to me. But there's always an advanced warning.
Yeah. I mean, again, my feeling is that AU's got the right policy, which is you leave it to the professor. If you're teaching about gender and war and you know that you're going to have a lot of students who are going to experience sexual assault, I mean, it sounds like that professor is doing a great job in terms of, you know, putting the warnings up there. And, you know, there might be other classes where the professors don't do it, or, I mean, again, I never thought of it as a trigger warning because we don't use that language, but I do say we're going to deal with a lot of sensitive, explosive stuff that's going to affect people in the classroom in different ways. What are the ground rules we should have? And again, I mean, we're dealing with somewhat older students. The average age at the law school is 24 or 25. But the students always say free speech and respect the other people in the classroom. But I think the syllabus does operate as a kind of trigger warning that you know what's coming up, right?
Yes and no. Yeah. I mean, like, yes, a gender and conflict class is gonna have something, like some mention of sexual assault, but knowing the specific days and professors just being honest about here's times where you may be uncomfortable is an extra step that some professors don't take that's more about trust than it is about the actual warning.
Gotcha. Thank you so much for what you told us, and I appreciate your kind words.
I wanted to say I'm really sorry that you had that experience. I'm sorry. And I'm very grateful for your courage and your clarity in coming forward. One of the things that you did for me was to help me to understand that by putting a trigger warning on, that I convey the message to my students, I see you. Mm-hmm. And that's something that won't be achieved if AU made a blanket, everybody must do this, because then it becomes just an automated. But when you have faculty who are thoughtful and sensitive in those ways, you will recognize them as they will recognize you. So thank you for that awareness.
I would just quickly add that I want to thank you for being so vulnerable, and so that's certainly a display of the that's really hard to do, and certainly a display of the PC personal courage that you mentioned as well. I would caution us to consider, though, while we can appreciate your professor who displayed a moment of trust and recognition for what the students in their classroom were inevitably some of them experiencing because of our demographics here, I would caution against your original professor who did not do that. And are we just going to say, well, we leave it up to faculty and we want them to be have all the personal freedom that they want and allow those things to happen at the expense of our students? And if we are okay with that, can our campus afford it? Is our counseling center properly staffed? Perhaps not. How do we market our school? Do we market it as a school where on the second page of our viewing book for prospective students we say, oh, we're very proud of our diversity, 28% of our students are students of color, they come from 150 countries in all 50 states. This is the first year that American University is almost 30% Pell eligible. The demographics of our school are changing, and if we want to include those voices in our class so that they are able to engage with the material despite the experiences that they are, again, inevitably having because of who is here and who is increasingly here, what are we going to do about professors who will say, well, that's what the real world is like, which you obviously knew. Yeah. You know, are there no consequences there? Do we not care?
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Sophia. I'm gonna move to another person. We have a lot of people queued up here. Would you say your name and state your question, please?
Hi, my name is Nick Callums. And my question, again, on the subject of trigger warnings, just I think we can have a greater discussion on that as well. I grew up and still am part of a military family. So issues of post-traumatic stress disorder have always been something that I've learned about firsthand. Luckily, my father was never subject to that unfortunate trauma. But I hear stories about it all the time, and it's very upsetting that members of the military go and serve and come back with emotional scarring, and a lot of times things can elicit a negative reaction. And I think that can be brought into a broader discussion or issue of, you know, how do we make sure that no one, and whatever the traumatic event being, mm-hmm. whether it be violence experience fighting the military or sexual violence or, you know, anything that can elicit such a powerful negative reaction while at the same time making sure that no topic is limited in that regard. And I guess one hypothetical example I'll give is that if there's a veteran who fought overseas and experienced a severe traumatic event overseas and came back to pursue a higher education, and it was in a class that discussed concepts of war and violence and battle. And how do we make sure that that person is able to both benefit and do well in that class and make sure that their perspective is both respected and challenged in an academic setting, and making sure that, you know, that any emotional reaction is not brought up that might bring back such negative memories.
Thank you.
Well, but I think you're raising exactly the same question. I mean, it's really the parallel question. And I don't know if you have, do you have experience with trigger warnings here?
I grew up in a very conservative area. I was not part of that majority. So coming to America, I'm a sophomore now, all of this was very new to me. So this has been a learning experience, a very large one for me, between safe spaces and trigger warnings. So No, not directly, but I've only been in an environment that uses any recollection of them for a little over a year now.
Yeah. Well, but I think, again, you know, if the professor is teaching a course on war, I don't know which one, if you're referring to the same one or if it's another course.
It was hypothetical.
Okay. And I think I mentioned that even in my opening remarks, that the professor should take whatever precautions, you know, she or he can to deal with that issue. But if the person is, you know, really in the throes of post-traumatic stress syndrome and is having nightmare flashbacks and so on, it's not even as if the student himself or herself could predict when they're going to, you know, because I just read Sebastian Younger's new book called Tribe, which is really interesting. A lot of it is about post-traumatic stress syndrome, and you know, he was a victim of it himself because he had been a journalist in a number of war zones, and he suffered it. And he said basically the majority of people who've been through war go through it, that it's totally the normal human response. And his argument, interestingly, is that people who live a normal, isolated life in America, because we have a pretty isolated kind of cultural existence here, have a very hard time getting over it. But people who live in a closer community where they can talk about it, where people ask them questions about it, where they're open about it. So, again, I'm learning a lot about the trigger warnings. I hope that they would be used to invite dialogue, mm-hmm. to help prepare people to be emotionally ready, if they can be ready, to participate and to, you know, share their experience if possible. And that's going to help them, and it's going to help everybody else understand what they've gone through. And again, it's going to form friendships and relationships.
I think also on that point, it ties into a lot of the fundamental misunderstanding of what trigger warnings are and why they're necessary. A trigger warning can be something as simple as like a heads up, you know, we're going to be discussing X, Y, and Z in the coming weeks, just to allow students to emotionally and mentally prepare themselves. I think interpersonal violence is a great example of these types of experiences that students bring into the classroom that inform how they're going to approach the material. And so by providing these trigger warnings, it doesn't limit material, it doesn't censor anything. In fact, it facilitates discussion on these topics by allowing students to mentally prepare themselves for the sensitive topics, so that way they themselves can also engage in these discussions as well. Because by not providing these trigger warnings, we're limiting the accessibility of, you know, the discussion of the classroom space to these students. So trigger warnings do nothing but facilitate discussion. They do nothing but promote academic freedom.
Can I ask one quick follow-up just for clarification? I think one major criticism that some may have over trigger warnings is that it gives students or anyone in a discussion the right to exclude themselves completely from even watching discussion or exhibiting discussion. Is that a fair assessment? Is that not true? I'm just learning for clarification.
No, I would say that is also part of the misunderstandings. I think by and large, students who demand trigger warnings are students who want to participate in class discussions. They're students who are paying large sums of money to go to the school and want to be able to engage with the material they're required to. And so I think the argument that by providing trigger warnings, we're allowing students to opt out of the classroom discussion is a fallacious one. That's sort of grounded in this idea that trigger warnings shouldn't be provided. But really, you know, trigger warnings, students who demand trigger warnings, or the bulk of them rather, are ones who want to engage, who want to opt into classroom discussions, not opt out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We are about 20 minutes over time, and I would like to make sure that we can address everyone's questions. So when you introduce yourself, would you please direct your question to a person on the stage, and then we'll be able to move through more quickly. And for those of you who would like to respond, but don't get an opportunity, just jot a note, and then we'll do a concluding remark, okay? Sir, would you like to go next?
Yes, hi, good evening. I'm sorry, what is your name?
My name is Sophia.
Sophia, yes. I will direct the question to you because My name is Jared Delaney, and I'm a current freshman here at American University. And one of the reasons I chose to come to American, one of the many reasons, was because of how an inclusive community we are. I am an openly gay student here at American University, and I'm an openly Republican voter. So my question for you is, I fear that if safe spaces are implemented on this campus, I will not be welcome in a safe space for the gay community because I'm a Republican voter, or in a Republican safe space because I'm an LGBT member of society. And I feel that if we do not open these safe spaces, the campus itself is already so inclusive where I am able to say I am a proud gay Republican. But if we close off and we individualize these areas, I and other students who are considered oxymorons in today's society will be lost and will have nowhere to go, and the campus won't feel as inclusive. So how would you address that situation?
That's a great question. Thank you. Well, I think that I have a two-part answer. First of all, I don't think necessarily that we can always police every safe space, right? We can't necessarily have a place where we say this is for our LGBTQ students to engage with one another in a place where they don't feel marginalized by the rest of our campus, where they can collectively have moments of healing, have moments of togetherness. And while I hope that we can make ways for that to be an inclusive space, but I don't think that's outside of what we're able to do. I think that sometimes there are intersections of our identities where there is complexity, as you're describing, but that doesn't mean that we can't address the complexity. And it doesn't mean that we should give up the idea altogether because we see challenges with how to implement it. You're right, there are issues in our intersecting identities, we've had safe spaces for students of color, safe students for women, and then also safe spaces for women of color. And so that's not to say that there can't be a safe space or a place of convening or a moment of togetherness for conservative LGBTQ students either. I wouldn't say that it excludes that. While I am agreeing that our campus is more inclusive than many others, I would also caution us to be believing that our campus is truly inclusive or even a safe space. I don't know if anyone has read Facebook today and is a student here, but I hope it's also unsettling to you to know that we have a fraternity, perhaps, that is throwing rotten bananas and pennies at our black female freshmen who have gotten here less than a month ago, they're clearly not safe. I hope that that's, you know, really making you think, wait, are we safe? Are our students safe? Those are our students too. We also have a fraternity or a underground fraternity, EI, that has these, you can look it up, EI, American University, it's actually a registered gang now, that has kind of publicized all of these things about rape tactics and kind of has all of this material on raping our female students. So I would caution us to believe that we really are a safe space that is totally inclusive.
Thank you. I'm sorry to say this, but because we've run a bit over, Professor Raskin is going to have to leave. I think the students and I could continue with you, but
I have one
this
question
should be...
that I'd like to direct to Senator Raskin, if that's okay, right before he leaves.
Sure.
Thank you, Sophia.
Thank you.
So the reason why my question is, I don't know if this is working or not, is specifically for Senator Raskin, is because I was actually quite perturbed by the response to the anecdote that the young man, I'm not sure your name, from Young Americans for Liberty gave earlier, wherein he was talking about how Milo Yiannopoulos came to campus and there was a counter-protest, but it seemed the ways in which the counter-protest was being very anti-free speech seemed to be very quickly dismissed by all members of the panel, except for the young man from Yale, which I think was his point. His point is that the counter-protest was trying to suppress the protest to that, and I think that given that speech is not, you know, a binary, that you don't just have a response and a counter response, that you have to also allow a response to that response, why that was so quickly dismissed. And second of all, on top of that, why the kind of very important campus activism that is happening is being dismissed with students should go out into the world and do important things, even though the kind of defense of free speech that the Yale chapter is clearly trying to do here is important, because there are controversial ideas that I hold, that a lot of liberals like me hold, like the fact that women should be able to talk about their reproductive rights, so that people should be allowed to talk about their sexual behaviors or things like that, would have been considered just as offensive as many people on the panel are considering, are
you know, pointing out different things today. So I'm wondering why campus activism is being considered less important than general activism, and why freedom of speech, when it disagrees with the ideals that some members of the panel seem to hold, is not considered valuable.
Okay, so on the first point, protest generates counter-protest. That's free speech generating more free speech. The suggestion that there was, that somebody in the crowd then said, get that journalist or photographer out of here. And that they didn't get rid of the person. I mean, there was no censorship that took place. Okay, so somebody expressed an intolerant point of view, just like the original speaker expressed an intolerant view in advocating, you know, suicide or self-decapitation by transgender individuals. So, you know, neither of them are going to be heroes to anybody. But protest generated counter-protest, and you had free speech. That's democracy. That's good, right? I mean, and so it goes back and forth. I mean, you don't want a heckler's veto where the protesters to the speech go in and make it impossible for the speaker to speak. Okay, but I didn't hear anything like that. The event proceeded, right?
Gentleman right there actually took care of that when that happened.
Okay, well, so, you know, there was proper security in place, so that didn't happen. On the other point, I do not mean to diminish in the slightest way campus activism, and I'm glad you raised that point. There are a lot of things where we need real campus activism, where we need to organize students across the identity politics lines. For example, I love the work that's going around in the country by students saying we have a civilizational emergency with climate change that's going to face this generation and your children in even more dramatic ways than it's facing us now, even though 2015 was the hottest year on record. After 2014, after 2013, we've had the hottest decade in human history. We need campus activism. And so, you know, it's not that I want to diss what you did or the protest, counter-protest, but there are important things going on. There are 680,000 people in this city in the year 2016 who still have no voting representation in Congress. And we've got smart, engaged, public-spirited students here who could be involved in a movement to deal with the civil rights of people who live in this city. And there's a crisis of literacy and so on. So it's not that I am dissing student activism. What I'm saying is that some of it appears to be very inward focused. You've raised my consciousness tonight about why, and there clearly are reasons why. I'm just giving you the perspective of somebody from a different generation. We fought to get the universities to divest from corporations operating in South Africa. That was a movement that we did interracially, multiculturally, to make that happen. And I've gone on to a career as a law professor, and I sponsored marriage equality and led the fight for that in Maryland. I sponsored the legislation to abolish the death penalty and led the floor fight for that. I led the floor fight for transgender civil rights. And we need students who are working on the legislation and who are protesting publicly, as well as raising consciousness on campus. All I'm saying is there are big fights taking place out there. And if you look at any of the movies about the civil rights movement, go please watch Eyes on the Prize, or the anti-war movement, is people your age who made the difference in all of those struggles across the
country. But how can you expect anyone to ever fight for a controversial topic if no one ever fights for the right to be controversial?
Well, I agree with that. If we're at the stage where you still have to fight for the right to be able to speak and to be controversial, then I'm completely with you. And I've never taught at the college. I've always taught at the law school. But I've been making assumptions, at least, based on my general sense of things and knowing some students, knowing faculty, that the campus is a safe space for students to get involved and engage with stuff. And to the extent it's not, then you guys are all doing the right thing.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Professor Raskin, thank you for joining us this evening.
Thank you for having me.
We will continue up here to hear all of your questions. Again, when you come to the microphone, please let us know to whom you're directing your question. All right, so we'll give people a minute to resettle.
Hi there, my name's Anna Marie Rienzi, and I'm a junior in the School of Public Affairs and Perhaps most importantly, I am the Outreach Director for Young Americans for Liberty. So my question is directed at any of the proponents of these trigger warnings, but I suppose, J.I., you can answer since you haven't had a question in a while. So my question is kind of invoking what Professor Raskin was saying earlier about specific policy proposals about these trigger warnings. So my concern personally is that there'll be an infinite number of these trigger warnings. What is considered, or my question to you is, can you put a cap? Can you have a distinguishable list of trigger warnings? Because for me personally, I can consider 9/11 a trigger. Like I grew up in New Jersey. My community was horribly affected by 9/11. I can consider the murdering of unborn lives to be a trigger. I can consider rape to be a trigger. I can consider violence to be a trigger. I mean, sure, anybody can consider death in the family to be a trigger. Again, my concern and my question to you is, can you put a cap on it, or is it just infinite and will change indefinitely?
So we'll have one person here address that, please.
Directed it to J.I.
J.I., okay, thank you.
That's actually a great question. I personally believe, and be welcome to disagree with me because that's the point in having a debate. But I personally believe that there is a way to have trigger warnings and also put a cap on it. And also at the same time, make sure that it's the best system, the most fair system, a system that's also kept in check. I understand the slippery slope argument, but I don't think that this slope is quite so slippery that we should say, all right, some students simply, are trying to engage in the classroom and they don't, or they cannot because they simply weren't informed of something, it caught them off guard, suddenly they can't focus as much as they would. But you know what, since I'm a little worried about the slippery slope argument, let's just not pay attention to that. I think there's still a way to be able to engage in this activity of what are things that we can all agree on that would trigger someone, and then find the correct institutional frameworks for implementing those. So for example, in the case of sexual assault, I think that's something that everyone would agree on. And then once we have that, then, for example, the College of Arts and Sciences could have a mental health professional that can make sure that they look through all the curriculum, all the curricula with the faculty and decide which ones are which are gonna be the syllabi that are gonna require that. And then you get into a consensus along with administrators, with students, and with professors, and you decide. And I think that the argument that it'll just cause a slippery slope and then we'll end up with a trigger warning for everything is, it's not realistic if we just try to implement it in the real world. And so for example, I'm a chemistry major, I'm taking a physics course right now. I know that they can't make triggers warnings mandatory for all courses because what kind of trigger will you have for physics? Like derivatives, it's not something that you can really, it's not really a course where you require one, but that doesn't mean that there still aren't places where I recognize that there are students who would benefit more from this than without this. And to claim that we shouldn't be, helping out these students simply because we're worried about the slippery slope, I don't think it's the right way to approach the situation. And I think there's a way to get everyone on the table and say, we all agree that we need to look out for the mental health of our students, let's do that. And I know it's a valid point that people bring up a lot, but I don't think that should be the deterrent for pursuing the betterment of our institutions.
Okay, thank you very much. In the interest of time, I'm sorry, I'm gonna keep us moving. We're a little after 9. Sir.
Hi, my name is John Nagel. I'm a senior here. I actually, in the spirit of brevity, I'd like to ask all four panelists a yes or no question, so it'll go quickly. And it's a hypothetical. So hypothetically, as a hypothetical example, if a student group were to invite David Duke, who's an avowed racist, to come to campus and to speak, and if you're in a position of power at the administration to decide if he should be allowed to speak or should not at AU's campus, would you choose to allow him to speak or not allow him to speak? So that's a yes or no question to all four panelists.
When I ask you to clarify, why is he being invited?
To share his thoughts on his views on political discourse, 2016 election, or whatever other thoughts that he has. Perhaps a Q&A with the students, seeing as he's already notorious and the students might have questions.
So is the question, would we want him to speak or would
no,
we
it's
allow
not
him
would
to?
You want him to speak. If you were in a position of power in AU's administration to either allow him to speak or stop him from coming to campus and speaking, what would you allow him or disallow him from
and
coming?
And is AU paying for him to come?
Let's assume he's coming pro bono.
Sorry?
Pro bono. He's not
pro bono.
Being paid
okay.
by American
Thank
University.
Thank you for the clarifications.
I would allow him to come, but there's a lot of nuance to that.
Okay.
J.I.?
It's a really tough question to ask, to answer, but yeah, I'd have to say yes, but please ask me later why, you know, it's not, it's not like, yes, have the KKK, of course not, but yes, if you want one word.
Andrew?
It depends. If there is no actual, like, if they come and talk about incredibly ridiculous and stupid ideas, that's fine, as long as there's no actual violence intended against the people of color at the school. I think it would be great to bring David Duke to campus so lots of our students of color could show him why he's a total idiot. It would be pretty easy. If you take somebody that sits behind a computer, somebody, and just click-clacks away about things that aren't even relatively true, and then face him with somebody that can, you know, refute why his beliefs are...
Excuse me, it was a yes-no.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry. Okay. I think it would be valid, but in the interest of time. Yeah.
Perhaps no.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hi, so my name is Rebecca Rahman, and I'm sorry, but this is going to be a little bit of a tangent, if that's all right, but my question is directed at Andrew. So you are obviously somebody I hold in very high esteem. I actually went to the Milo Yiannopoulos event as a Muslim and queer woman, and we actually had a very great dialogue that spurned from it. I would diminish the quality by saying that I believe he has changed as a person. So the place I want to bridge from that is I think we still have a responsibility as minorities and marginalized group to step forward and engage in these conversations. The problem is, for a lot of us, I think we need to ask why there aren't groups like AU Rad Queers or the AU Student Workers Alliance who are attending events like this to speak out and offer a contrarian opinion. I think that can be either because there is not a predilection to do so or a resentment and anger towards that, but that doesn't build or foster the kind of dialogue that is necessary. On the other hand, I would say that for certain events like the Milo Yiannopoulos one, where there are contrarian viewpoints who come to speak, they can suffer from harassment. For example, Stephanie Black was one of the silent protesters during that event. She simply held up a sign and she was told to fuck off. Among other things, there was another woman who came to the Q&A for the Milo Yiannopoulos event and advocated for gassing of SJWs. So when we ask the questions of why they don't feel comfortable enough to come out and speak, it is because of principle number 3, no harassment or destruction of the learning environment. Mm-hmm. I think it's also safe to say that a lot of this crowd is a bit more right-leaning. There has to be a bridge between both sides to foster that camaraderie, and that comes from addressing these issues, as well as acknowledging that, yes, as Sophia pointed out, harassment has not ended at AU. There are still a variety of problems, sexual assault, targeting of people of color, and among other things. So how, as a group that has somehow found itself in the crux of polarization for free speech crusaders being these kind of villainized and caricatured hicks, hillbillies, these slurs, on the other hand, at that polarized spectrums, over-simulated, sensitive, or as a slur, crybabies, how do we break that down to foster that dialogue, Andrew?
Well, so the one thing I'll say is that if any sort of harassment is occurring, harassment is absolutely punishable by law, and that should be reported. The person should be punished for harassing another student, especially in the face of physical violence. But at the same time, we actually got some rather interesting backlash on Yik Yak about the Milo Yiannopoulos event. John Nagel, who was the president of the chapter at the time, was reportedly a homosexual that slept with 7 members of the AU soccer team, and he enjoys being urinated on during the act. I know some students here at AU that would consider that as harassment if somebody were to make some kind of false rumor about them towards an individual. We obviously don't. But in terms of how to break down the dialogue, to a position where it's possible for a marginalized group to come and, you know, take on an idea that goes against their will. I almost saw it happen at the Milo event. At the very end, unfortunately, we ran out of time. A lot of the students from, I will preface this, I support Black Lives Matter. We at Yale support criminal justice reform. I was happy that the darkening came and did what they did to some of the dumb things Milo said. Unfortunately, because they had protested, entered the event late, some of the students from the darkening didn't actually get to come up to the microphone because they were so far back in line in the room, and I wish there were an opportunity for somebody to have challenged Milo and his beliefs about Black Lives Matter. But I think in terms of the discussion you had with Milo, I think it went fairly well with you being able to break down that barrier. So it's got to take some courage from individuals that see those ideas as wrong, but I'm not sure, if you're particularly offended so much that you feel disincentivized to go and speak out, I have no idea how that could be remedied, honestly.
That is true, and I will recognize Thank that you. There were many people who attended the event who reported later on that they were harassed and physically harassed after attending the event just by going and supporting Milo speaking, so I understand that too.
Thank you very much. Again, I'm sorry to be short, but we are way over time, and I want to make sure we get these last three questions in. Yes, sir.
Thanks. Hi, my name is Jonah. I'm a senior in the School of Public Affairs. My question was, back in the Dark Ages, was going to be intended for Professor Raskin. I'll ask you, Dean Pascal, to, respond to it in his stead. I want to push back on, I think, the sort of a straw man that we keep hearing when we talk about trigger warnings on syllabi and in the classroom. A number of times, panelists, Professor Raskin and others, have brought up this idea of, say, the veteran who's taking a class that has to do with war, or a survivor of sexual violence who's taking a class that has to do with women's studies, and so will sort of course, involve discussion of topics of sexual violence. That stuff happens, but I think the thing that we keep forgetting about is either or both of those students who take a class on, European cinema, where one of the films has a battle scene or has a scene that depicts sexual violence. And so I think so much of the conversation about trigger warnings is about encouraging professors to be mindful to say, hey, by the way, there's a scene in this film, it depicts this thing, you may want to skip over the scene, or you may want to prepare yourself a little extra, take some time before or after you watch. So rather than, I think we've conditioned ourselves to think that it's about these classes that are sort of always about what, triggering material. Mm-hmm. When in fact, I think so much about trigger warnings is preventing those surprises. So I'm wondering how, considering that, you as, I suppose in this case, a representative of the faculty might move forward in terms of, sort of working with presenting that kind of material.
Thank you. As the dinosaur on the panel, I don't think this is an issue that is solved by a policy. I don't think that we can say a mandate, all syllabi need to have trigger warnings. We can't really compensate for a lack of compassion through this sort of legislation. Mm-hmm. And that it's really important that we cultivate compassion and insight among our faculty to be sensitive to the kinds of issues that can come up. If you're not sensitive to suffering in your own life, it's hard to be sensitive to the suffering in someone else's. So I think that there's a lot of awareness that needs to be cultivated, and that's the conversation that I'd like to see us engage in.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name is Robert Wines, and my question is directed towards Devante. It seems that all of you guys really want an environment where there's free discourse and obviously the progression that ensues from that. But my question really comes to the fact that how do these safe spaces differ from echo chambers where like-minded thinkers talk with like-minded thinkers, and it just becomes an area where people get more and more radicalized, totally destroying any discourse and development from that?
So I think the fundamental premise of safe spaces is to provide a space for students who have traditionally been marginalized and oppressed to go through some sort of healing process. When you're in an institution that is founded on, you know, white supremacy, on patriarchy, on sexism, you find that you're not often welcomed in these spaces, right? And so safe spaces make these institutions more palatable to people who are meant to be excluded from it. Safe spaces allow you to go through this healing process that you otherwise wouldn't be able to, so that way you can go into the classrooms, you can go into these different community meetings and engage in a way that you probably couldn't have before. So I wouldn't say that safe spaces act as an echo chamber, but rather as a healing chamber. And they allow people with these similar experiences, people of a certain affinity group, to come together and provide community that they wouldn't get otherwise.
Okay, thank you.
Can I follow up to that?
Okay. Briefly.
So are you basically suggesting that American University is a place that people feel that there's white supremacy and a patriarchal rule over them at all times?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Are you basically suggesting that American University is a place where there's white supremacy and patriarchal rule over them, where they really need to come back and regroup at all times?
Yeah, I think you need to, I think in any of these instances, you have to consider the social and historical context of these things. I think American University is just an individual microcosmic example, but you really have to take into consideration the institutions that factor into how American University functions. And so yes, there are several students on this campus who feel that white supremacy, that patriarchy, that sexism operate against them on a daily basis. So yes, I would say that is the case.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, sir.
Okay. My name is Steven, and my question's kind of directed at you, Devante. Sorry, I'm going to take the brunt on the last two questions. So we kind of briefed over it between the whether or not we can define what the roast was on Ann Coulter as wanting her to kill herself, and if that's affecting her, and whether transgenders will be affected in the same way. So my question would be, how do you bifurcate that it's okay and it won't affect Ann Coulter, because you said I wouldn't compare it to what happened to Ann Coulter, when it, how would you bifurcate the two, because what was said to Ann Coulter could be equally as bad as what's said to a transgender, mm-hmm. and is it through your idea that, like, sort of soft bigotry of low expectations that transgender folks can't handle that same joke, or are you going to define it as, would you define it as no one can say it so that it doesn't hurt anyone?
So thank you for your question. I didn't say that I wouldn't equate the two. I said I would hesitate to. I think the Ann Coulter situation would require a lot more examination, but on its face, what happened with Milo Yiannopoulos and the transgender comment that he made was specifically targeted towards a demographic that is constantly undermined and under attack. And so I think in any instance, you shouldn't tell anyone they should commit suicide. I think that's problematic on its face. That's just something you should never do. But I said I would hesitate to equate the two because I think there's a lot more nuance that needs to go into comedy, but that's not to say that you should joke about suicide. I think that Milo's specific comments were advocating for a certain group of people that are currently and will continue to be oppressed under the certain institutions we have in place to kill themselves. And so I think there's a historical and current context that needs to be taken into consideration when you're speaking about an entire demographic like that. And so the comment about Ann Coulter, if I was, you know, writing the jokes for him, I wouldn't put that in there. It's something that you shouldn't joke about. You should never say it. Again, I would hesitate to equate the two because I think the Ann Coulter situation needs a little more examination. But on its face, the comment Milo made was specifically about an entire demographic of people who are currently oppressed.
Thank you. I think this falls under Jamie Raskin's don't be a jerk kind of comment, right? So I have to extend a heartfelt thank you to all of the staff who has stayed late tonight to make this happen for us. many people here who have had an extremely long day to make sure that everyone got a chance to speak. I want to thank Andrew, Sophia, J.I., and Devante for your thoughtful comments this evening. And a special shout out to Mimi Fittig, who is the wizard of all things here. So many thanks, and I hope that the conversation continues, that this is one part in an ongoing process that will open conversations to come. Thank you very much for your time and your thoughtfulness.
Thank you.